So it is a pleasure to have Dimitri Betsakos from University of Thessaloniki, who will be talking on exit time of Brownian motion from a planar domain. Dimitri.
Thank you, Nicola. I would like first to thank the organizers of this seminar for giving me this opportunity. Nicola Arcozzi, my old friend and fellow student. And also Marco Pelloso, whom I think we have met Marco 30 years ago in St. Louis, and also Filippo Bracci, whom I haven't met, but I hope to meet him soon. And also I thank all of you for being here. The title of my talk is The Exit Time of Brownian Motion from a Planar Domain. I will make a very brief and informal introduction to Brownian motion. I will present some open problems on that subject, and I will present also some recent results we had in a joint work with Maher Boudabra and Greg Markovsky from Australia, from Monash University. And I will start by presenting some classical extremal problems, complex analytic extremal problems. And first I need to define the Green function for a domain. We will have a simply connected domain D in the plane, not the whole plane, and it will contain the origin. The Green function with pole at the origin will be denoted with GD of Z, or GD Z and zero, if we want to emphasize that the origin is the pole. This is a function which is harmonic in D except the origin. It is zero on the boundary. It tends to infinity at the origin. So it has a singularity at zero, but this singularity is logarithmic in the sense that if you add log mod z, you get a harmonic function. The physical interpretation of this quantity is that this function is that you put a unit current at zero, and this produces a potential in D. You ground the boundary so that the potential is equal to zero on the boundary. And so you have a function which is infinity at zero, and it decreases harmonically to zero in D. It is, by the maximum principle, is always a positive function. We will need this function, and also we will need a domain constant, which is called the inner radius of the domain D. And it is defined this way. We said that this function is harmonic in D, and we take the limit at zero. And this is denoted by gamma D. And e to the gamma D is R of D, the inner radius of D at zero. This function has many applications in function theory, potential theory, and other subjects. I want you to have an intuitive understanding of this function as the mean distance of the boundary points from zero. This can become rigorous. It is not so well known, but I want you to have just an intuitive understanding of this. And there are two other equivalent definitions of inner radius. One is that inner radius is equal to conformal radius. That is, you take the Riemann mapping, a Riemann mapping, sending zero to zero, and the modulus of the derivative at zero is exactly the inner radius. This is the complex analytic definition of inner radius, and a geometric definition is that is one over the density of the hyperbolic metric at zero. But I want to emphasize that if the domain is not simply connected, but it is multiply connected, then these three things are not equal. And in higher dimensions also, the inner radius can be defined via the Green function, but you cannot have such a definition in higher dimensions. Now, let's see some examples of domains with inner radius 1. We will see in a moment some extremal problems for such domains. Simply connected domains with inner radius 1. Some examples first. The unit disk has inner radius 1. This is obvious. The Quebe domain is another domain, famous domain with inner radius 1. It is this domain. You all know it. The half plane with distance here 1/2 has inner radius 1. And the strip with width pi over 2 has also inner radius 1. So the inner radius depends heavily on the geometry, on the global geometry of the domain. But especially, one can say that it depends first on the distance of 0 from the boundary. Here is 1 the distance, here is 1/4 the distance. But also it depends on how the boundary surrounds the point zero. Okay. Now the extremal problems that I promised. One is the famous Bieber-Bach conjecture, the theorem that the branches proved in 1985. We have a D-simply connected domain within a radius 1. We consider the conformal mapping, the Riemann mapping. Since the inner radius is 1, this has modulus 1, the first coefficient. 0 goes to 0. And you consider the supremum, the problem of finding the supremum the modulus of the coefficients over all such domains. And the supremum is n, the supremum of An is n. And the Quebe domain is the extremal domain. This is the deep theorem of De Brandt. And it is trivial that the corresponding minimum problem, the infimum of overall such domains of the coefficients is zero. This is trivial. And the extremal domain is the unit disk. And another famous problem is the problem of integral means for the conformal mapping, the Riemann mappings. This was proved by Bernstein in 1974. If you take the P means of the Riemann mapping over smaller circles, the supremum is attained again for the Quebe function. This is the Quebe function. And P is from 0 to infinity, not equal to 0, of course, here's a mistake. And then also for the Green function, the supremum of the Green function of such a domain with inner radius 1 over circles, here we define the Green function to be 0 outside the domain, is again, this is maximized when we have the Quebe domain. This perhaps is not so well known, but actually it is inside the proof of this deep inequality of Bernstein. Also, you can have here P powers and actually even more general functionals of Green function. Now, for the infimum, again, the minimal domain is the unit disk. And this is, in fact, also trivial. While this is very deep, the supremum is very difficult. And the proof is three lines, so I can present it. You factor out 1z here. So you have the Riemann mapping is z times g of z. And if you take the integral means of the Riemann mapping, you substitute this with z times g of z. So you have r to the p here times g to the power p. R to the p goes outside, and you use the subharmonicity of the function mod g to the power p. So this is greater than g of 0 to the power p. But g of 0 is this e to the I t has modulus 1. So this is r to the p. And this is exactly the integral means of the, this is the Riemann mapping for the unit disk, that is the identity function or a rotation. So this is exactly r to the power p. So again, you see that the Koebe domain maximizes a functional, the unit disk minimizes the same functional. So it is rather reasonable to arrive to the following intuitive principle. Among all simply connected domains with inner radius 1, the unit disk is the smallest and the Koebe domain is the largest. And there are many problems where this principle applies, but there are counterexamples. And the most famous is the problem of covering disks. The unit disk covers the largest disk centered at the origin, which is D itself. It has radius 1, while the Koebe domain covers the smallest disk centered at 0. This is the Koebe's 1/4 theorem. And you see here that the smallest disk centered at 0 is contained in the Koebe domain. Or for all other simply connected domains of inner radius 1, larger disks are contained. So we must be careful. Sometimes the principle does not apply. All right, this was a small introduction into extremal problems. And now I will go to Brownian motion, and I will present a very informal and brief introduction. What is a Brownian motion? Consider the set omega of all paths omega, that is continuous functions on 0 plus infinity with complex values, and omega of 0 is 0. So we consider all such red paths starting from 0 in the plane. This will be the sample space in a probability space. And Norbert Wiener in 1923 proved that there is a probability space, that is a measure here on omega, such that this stochastic process, which sends omega to the plane with a formula Zt of omega is omega of t, has the following property. If you take a finite number of times and you consider these random variables, then they have joint density, this product of functions p, where p, pxy, is this function, which is a function, a Gaussian function, and the people, the experts on PDEs, know it as the heat kernel. It is a solution of the heat equation for a fixed x as a function of t and y, for example. It is a solution of the heat equation. Of course, what I defined here is a Brownian motion starting from 0. And by the same argument, one can define Brownian motion starting from any point on the plane. And the probabilistic interpretation of this function, which is called the transition function of the Brownian motion, is that It represents the probability that a Brownian motion starting from x after time t is at y in the sense of density. So a Brownian motion is a motion in the plane governed by this function. And I will present some basic properties of Brownian motion so that non-experts can have at least an intuitive understanding of the motion. This comes easily from the definition. If you have an open set in the plane, the probability that a Brownian motion starting from zero is in A after time t, that is omega t is inside A, is given by this integral. And substituting the function p, you get this integral. And you see that using this property, one can make calculations and find explicit probabilities for various sets A. But also this property also implies some obvious symmetry properties. For example, if you rotate A, this probability does not change because you have this absolute value here. And also if A is very close to the origin here and you rotate around the origin, the probability does not change, which means that Brownian motion starts from zero without any preferred direction. Another property is that we can consider a random variable, which is called the exit time. It is the first time that Brownian motion starting from the origin exits this domain D. This is a random variable. And of course, this time depends on omega. It depends on the path. This will be the main object of this talk. Now, there is also another quantity, which is called the expected lifetime of the Brownian motion in the domain D. Sometimes we say that if a domain hits the boundary and it is killed at that time, we speak about a killed Brownian motion or a motion in D. So the expected value of the exit time is the lifetime, the expected lifetime of the Brownian motion. The first two formulas are obvious. This comes from Fubini's theorem. And this probability is called the survival probability of the Brownian motion in D. And it is the probability that the Brownian motion will live more than time t. But the last equality is really surprising. It is impressive. This is the Green function. Recall that this is the Green function. This is area integral. So this expected lifetime, which is a probabilistic quantity, is equal to this integral of the Green function on the domain D. And this equality represents a deep connection between potential theory and Brownian motion. Such equalities and many others were discovered by Kakutani, Dube, Hunt in the 1950s. The basic property of Brownian motion is the Markov property. It has a very concrete and rigorous statement. Here I will say only that an intuitive statement, that is, if you take a time is zero, positive, and you consider this process, that is the Brownian motion after time t0, Then this is a new Brownian motion starting from the random point ZT naught. So if you are here, what you will see after this moment is again a Brownian motion. So the Brownian motion does not depend on how we arrived here, but only on the starting point. The future depends only on the present and not on the past for Brownian motion. Or the Brownian motion, the Brownian traveler never gets tired. Every moment he starts a new motion. So this at least intuitively implies that almost surely the Brownian paths are nowhere differentiable. We cannot have here a preferred direction for Brownian motion. We cannot have a tangent. We cannot have a velocity here. The Brownian paths are almost surely nowhere differentiable. Of course, this is a deep theorem of Zygmund, I think. Also, there are some other symmetry properties. Let's consider the unit disk here. Take a set on the boundary, a Borel set E. Brownian motion starts from zero. Then, because of the symmetry of Brownian motion, if one moves this E around the circle without changing the length of E, the probability that the Brownian motion starting from zero exit the disk through E is the same. In other words, this is the probability I told you before, the probability for a Brownian motion starting from zero at the point of exit, at the exit time, to belong at E is the length of E over 2 pi. And this is also called the harmonic measure at zero of the set E. And this holds more generally for any point Z. If you start from here, then the probability that you exit the disk through E is large. While if you start from here, this probability is very small. You have more probability to exit from the rest of the boundary. So this function has the same boundary behavior as the harmonic measure. So in order to prove this inequality, one have to prove that this function is harmonic, and actually using the symmetry of Brownian motion, one can prove that this function has the mean value property, so it is harmonic. I will move to some results of Burkholder from 1977, connecting hard spaces HP and expected lifetimes of Brownian motion. Here is the conformal mapping FD of the unit disk onto a simply connected domain. Burkholder proved that this mapping is in the hard space HP if and only if this moment of the exit time, that is the expected time, expected value of this random variable, the exit time to the power pi over 2, is finite. And actually, the Hardy norm is equivalent to that. And actually, the result of Burkholder is much more general. It's for general holomorphic functions, not conformal maps. There is a conjecture of Markovsky, 10 years old, that says that for this quantity, the maximal domain is the Quebe domain. This is for p between 0 and 1/2, because otherwise this is infinity, so the conjecture is trivial. This remains open, and It is reasonable because of this result. This quantity is more or less the Hardy norm. And by Bernstein's theorem, the Quebe Hardy norm is maximal. But actually, we don't know here exactly the relation. We don't know constants. And so, although the conjecture is reasonable, actually, it is open. Now, some conjectures about the Brownian motion and the exit time of Brownian motion of Burgess Davies from 1979. He first remarked that ED, the exit time, is an intuitively appealing measure of the size of D. And he made three conjectures. For such domains, we spoke before. So D is simply connected, and its inner radius is one. The first conjecture says that the survival probability for the unit disk is minimal. The second is somewhat easier. It says that the expected lifetime for the unit disk to the power p is less than this for any other such domain. So again, D is the smallest domain. For the maximal expected lifetime, Davis didn't dare to make a conjecture, but he asked, in what sense, with regard to the exit time, is the Quebe domain the largest domain? And a few years later, Terry McConnell proved that the first conjecture is false, but the second conjecture is true. And this is a very nice paper, two-page paper, with very short and clever arguments. He disproved this by a counterexample, and he proved this by using some convexity inequalities. So he, for this problem, for but he disproved the first conjecture for small t. Showed that for small t, this cannot be true. And he gave an counter example. And recently, we proved that actually, the Quebe domain is the smallest for this problem. That is, the survival probability for small t is smallest for the Quebe domain. This calls for small t, okay? Not in general. So for small t, what is important is the distance from the boundary. That's the idea. And the Quebe domain has the smallest distance of the origin to the boundary. So Brownian motion will hit very soon the boundary. I will return to this later. Now, we modified the conjectures of Davis and we restated them for large T. So we believe that for large T, indeed the unit disk is the smallest and the Quebe domain is the largest. Not for all T as Davis conjectured. This inequality for the Quebe domain seems to be very difficult, and I don't have any idea. But actually, this is not so difficult. It comes from known results, and now I will present the very short proof of this, of the left inequality, this one. So for large t, indeed, the unit disk has the smallest survival probability. To prove that, we need another quantity, which has at least seven names: fundamental frequency, bass note, bass tone, principal frequency, fundamental tone, first eigenvalue of the Laplacian, bottom of the spectrum of the Laplacian. And I will use the first one, fundamental frequency. Suppose that the domain D is a drum. And we all know that if one beats the drum, he or she will hear a tone. This tone is exactly the fundamental frequency of the drum, of the domain. And it is the first eigenvalue of the Laplacian with Dirichlet boundary conditions. But I will prefer this definition, which holds even if we don't have eigenvalues. So this lambda D is a domain constant of the domain. And it is defined to be the infimum of all smooth functions which are zero on the boundary of this quotient, the Dirichlet integral over the L2 norm of the function. This is called the Rayleigh-Ritz formula. It's very old. And another old result of Polya and Zege says that if the inner radius is one, then the smallest fundamental frequency is attained for the unit disk. This is in the opposite direction of another famous inequality of Faber and Kran that says that among all domains with the same area, the unit disk has the smallest eigenvalue. The proof of this result of Polya and Zege, it was the first proof that used a technique called the conformal transplantation. One uses the conformal mapping here, the disk, and the first eigenfunction of the Laplacian for the disk, which is known, it is a Bessel function. I need to say also that this infimum is attained for the unit disk for the first eigenfunction. The function for which this is attained is called the first eigenfunction of the unit disk. And if you take the composition here and uses this as a competing function in this infimum and some properties of the Bessel function, one gets this result. This is more or less the proof. We also need another result that connects eigenvalues, the principal frequency, with Brownian motion. I have found at least three papers with this formula. And in all these three papers, this was referred as the well-known formula without any reference. So I called it the well-known formula. And finally, I found the proof of this formula in Zittmann's book on Brownian motion, a very nice book. This says that for large t, the limit as t tends to infinity, this limit that involves the survival probability, exactly what we need, is equal to the principal frequency. Again, this is an impressive formula connected to different things. This is has to do with the Rayleigh-Ritz quotient. This is Brownian motion. What we need is this formulation. For t large, the asymptotic behavior of this survival probability is exponential, decreases exponentially with this exponent. This is the same thing. And now the proof of theorem one is one line. This survival probability is this. By the Polya-Zege theorem, we have this inequality, and this is exactly the survival probability of the unit disk. So this is the proof of theorem one. If there is any question, please do not hesitate to interrupt me. Now, I will make some remarks about this function, the survival probability. This well-known formula is almost useless when the principal frequency is zero. And there is an old and very nice result of Mackay, which was rediscovered by Heyman, that says that this principal frequency is zero, which means that you beat the drum and you don't hear anything, if and only if this in the radius is finite. In the radius is a geometric quantity, it's not the inner radius. The inner radius of D is the radius of the largest disk in D. So if the domain is very, very large, if it contains arbitrarily large disks, then and only then the principal frequency is zero. So that's why we don't use very large drums. Now, if the inner radius is infinity, so the domain is very large, for example, if the domain is the Koebe domain, which contains arbitrarily large disks, then the principal frequency is zero, and the behavior of this survival probability is not well understood. There are several results for special domains, like cones, even in higher dimensions, and parabolas. They are published in the best probability journals, but they are special cases. They are deep theorems, very nice theorems, but only for special cases. In general, this is not well understood. We don't have exponential decay anymore. We have some polynomial decay, but we don't know exactly how the geometry of the domain is related to the survival probability. Now, the last thing I would like to explain is a more general result about fast exits. We saw before that for simply connected domains with inner radius one, the Koebe domain is the smallest domain. It has the smallest survival probability. Now, this result is more general. We drop the assumptions of simply connectivity. It is irrelevant. And also the assumption that the inner radius is one is also irrelevant, we found. We found that what is important is only the distance from the boundary, but not all of the boundary. Because if we drop the assumption of simply connectivity, the boundary can be very complicated. For Brownian motion, some parts of the boundary are not important. So we consider the regular part of the boundary, the regular points of the boundary. And we look at the distance of the origin to the regular part of the boundary. And if for the domain U, this distance is smaller, then the survival probability is smaller for this domain. Now, what is the regular part of the boundary? I use the term in the usual sense, regular for the Dirichlet problem. That is, the solution of the Dirichlet problem for such domain converges to the correct boundary values at the regular points. This is the regular part of the boundary. But there is a Brownian motion interpretation of these points. The regular points are the points that Brownian motion recognizes. If a point is, a boundary point is, for example, if it is isolated, then Brownian motion cannot see it. It is an irregular point. The definition, the probabilistic definition of regular points is the following. If you start a Brownian motion for a regular point, then you will be in the complement of the domain in arbitrarily small time intervals. That is, you will hit the complement many times in a very small time interval. That is, there is a lot of boundary around the regular points. Of course, maybe you know the Wiener criterion for regular points that found by Wiener in the same year that he discovered the Brownian motion, 1923, which says exactly the same thing. Near the regular points, there is a lot of boundary, and he measures that using logarithmic capacity. Now, I would like to make some comments on the proof. The proof is rather technical, so I don't want to present it all the proof, but just a few comments. The first is that we can make some reductions. One domain W can be the unit disk. All the points are here regular, and all the points have distance one. The other domain, the small domain, is actually this domain, can be this domain without loss of generality, essentially. It is the complement of a very, very small, a tiny set here having positive capacity, having one regular point, which I call A. But this point is closer to zero than one. So the distance from the boundary for this domain is smaller. Here is one, here is smaller than one. Although this domain is huge, it's the complement of very tiny set. You can imagine here a Cantor set of length one, zero, but capacity positive. This domain has smaller survival probability. And this is a first reduction, and you can write this inequality. I consider the complementary probabilities. So we have to prove that. The unit disk has smaller such probability than this L domain. Another result we use in this proof is that this result of McConnell, who found the more or less the asymptotic behavior for T small for the unit disk. It is almost e to minus 1 over 2t. Another technique we use is the following. This is this small set L. Take a large disk containing L and consider Brownian motion killed upon hitting the boundary of the disk. Now, this killed Brownian motion is a transient process now, while the whole Brownian motion in the plane is a recurrent process. Recurrent means that it will pass from L again and again infinite times with probability one, while a transient process is not recurrent. It has some probability positive to hit L, but maybe it will not hit L any other time. So it cannot pass from L again and again. This is a transient process. This is an important step because the transient processes have a different potential theory. For example, for transient processes, we have this formula. This is the probability that we hit L before hitting the circle. And this is given by this potential theoretic formula. This is the Green function of the disk. This is the equilibrium measure of L with respect to delta. It is defined using energy and such things. And this is the transition probability of killed Brownian motion. That is, we start from Z, and this is the probability that after time S, we are at zeta without exiting delta. This is the transition probability, transition density for the killed process. One uses such results. The last thing I want to say is that we need another probabilistic principle, which is called principle of not filling the boundary. This was formulated by Mark Kack in 1951 and says that for T very small, the transition density for the disk is more or less equivalent than the transition density for the whole process. Of course, this density is bigger than that, but we have less than a constant times that for the killed process. Of course, again, I say that this is called also the heat kernel of the disk. It is a solution of the heat equation. So in other words, one can say that for the Brownian particles emanate from zero and they diffuse here from zero with the same law as the heat is diffused from a heat source here. Anyway, this principle of not filling the boundary holds for T very small. And some years later, Kack formulated this intuitively with these words. As the Brownian particles begin to diffuse, they are not aware, so to speak, of the disaster that awaits them when they reach the boundary. So for a very small time interval here, the Brownian particles behave as if they will live forever. Isn't it the same as the behavior of young people? I would like to finish with the last step of this proof, using these complicated arguments that I didn't present. One finds this inequality. Now one uses that this heat kernel is a decreasing function of the modulus of zeta. And when zeta is in the set L, it is smaller than that. This is the modulus of the regular point plus a small number delta. And this is smaller than one because we are in the unit disk. So this does not depend anymore on zeta. You can pull it out of the integral, do a Fubini here, and use the fact that the equilibrium measure of L is the capacity of L with respect to delta. This is called also the condenser capacity. This is a constant. We can omit it. Here we use the principle of not filling the boundary and substitute the heat kernel for the killed motion with the heat kernel for the whole Brownian motion. One substitutes the formula, the Gaussian function here, and you get that. And this is, if delta is very small and epsilon is here very small, this is bigger than that. And by McConnell's result, we have this is the probability for the disk that finishes the proof of theorem. I think I will stop here. Grazie mille.
Thank you. Are there questions or remarks?
I have a couple of questions, Dimitri. Well, first of all, thank you very much. It was a really wonderful talk. So the first one is more philosophical. I guess it's the following. Do you think it's possible to reinterpret the Brennan conjecture in terms of this extremal inner radius or probability as you did for the other problems?
I think you are asking too much. I don't think so, but I don't know. I cannot say anything.
Okay, well. And the second question is, this I guess you know, maybe even the other, but it was just mainly curiosity. So now if you do have star-like domain, which are essentially those which were extremal, they are this one. So they represent the Koenig domain of a semigroup, let's say. Can you interpret your comparison results in terms of dynamics of the corresponding semigroups?
Nice question. I haven't thought of this. I would say that I believe that maybe one can have some results for special domains, but I'm not ready to say something more concrete.
Okay. Thank you.
Are there other questions?
Yeah, may I ask you one thing, Dimitri?
Yes.
So I was curious about the result you mentioned by Bernstein, where he solved this extremal problem for circles, right, of radius r.
Yes.
So I was thinking that it's probably much more easy to solve the corresponding extremal problem when you replace the circles integrals over circles by integrals, area integrals. Should this be much more easy?
For area integrals, I suppose that directly for area integrals, I don't know.
It should, I guess it follows trivially, right, from the result of...
it follows from that with another integration, but...
Yeah, but it should be much
but
more...
directly, I don't know, maybe you are right, but I haven't seen it before.
Okay, thanks.
I have one remark is that this principle of CAC, this principle of CAC in terms of a heat equation is rather intuitive. I just come from teaching engineers about the heat equation. It means that if you cool a boundary far away for a small time, you don't feel it in, you know, if you're in the center of the room.
Yeah.
That's another way to state it. Now, and then I was curious, you had, I think, in four or three of these series of things. So you had the. Can you just go up a couple of slides? You had the equilibrium measure, right? Right. Which is the last exit from the set. Isn't it? It's like distribution of the exit.
It is the distribution of last exit from L, but before leaving delta.
Right. Yeah. Because you have this problem with recurrent Brownian motion in the plane, right?
Yes.
Can you just see the formula, just because I was curious again?
Which formula?
The one where you had the equilibrium measure, because I found it curious.
This one or later, I have this again here. Here, I just used the fact that.
Okay, for some reason, I only see the page 21. I think it was page 19, maybe, or 20.
No, here you don't see here.
No, but maybe I am the only one. Maybe I have a problem with the.
No, we still see. Yeah,
I think this is the place where I used this equilibrium measure. I didn't use it anywhere else.
Okay, so you
also used it. I used it here.
So use the measure anyhow, even though I cannot see, as a substitute for a harmonic measure somehow, in this very general thing, right? Or
the problem was that this general thing was very difficult for me. Maybe if it is a Cantor set, maybe it has even length zero. So I wanted to enter somehow the capacity, because capacity is exactly what has probabilistic in the interpretation. And that's why I used this equilibrium measure and the capacity of the condenser capacity.
Okay.
I found this trick in a paper by Gregorian and Salov Poste.
Ah, okay, so to look at this paper. I was telling you before the seminar, I tried for some time to decipher a paper from the 70s of Kalaichung, in which he had some formula like this for these general processes. Okay.
Yeah, and in fact, one can try to prove such things for more general processes than Brownian motion. Uh-huh. But maybe this is difficult.
Yeah, no. But it was the same formula. Okay. No, I found it interesting. But I found it interesting the how you used it. Okay, thanks a lot. Are there other questions? Remarks? Well, let's thank Dimitri again. Okay, thanks, Dimitri. Hope to see you soon for live.